Hello everyone. Today I'd like to share 5 Unity C# tips and tricks that you may not have known before. So without further ado, let's start. Alright, so for tip number 1, I have this little example to show. Say we wanted to move these sprites right here from left to right in order. What I mean by that is once the first sprite moves from left to right, the second one should start moving from left to right and so on. And I have a little script that already does that. It takes in an array of transforms that we want to move from left to right. And if we go ahead and look at that script, we can see that it's not very clean. As you can see, it has some repeated lines of code. And this is kind of the first approach of doing this, which is not very ideal. So how about we fix this? Alright, so here's what I've done. I have created a new enumerator which moves a single sprite. And I've created a for each loop which loops through this array right here and grabs every sprite. And for each sprite, it starts this coroutine and then it waits for the constant duration that we have for each coroutine that we start. Alright, so if we run this, the result should be the same. So what if we didn't know when this enumerator finished? What if we had a lot of if statements that affected the time of completion of this coroutine? And what if this coroutine did much more than just moving? Well, here is when tip number 1 comes in handy. What we can actually do is we can wait until a coroutine finishes inside of a coroutine. We can do this like so by using yield return and then writing the name of our enumerator and passing in all of the arguments. This ensures that the enumerator that we're calling finishes before we can continue to the next lines of code in our enumerator right here. And that's it for tip number 1. Furthermore, you can actually use a link expression to simplify all of this, just like so. Moving on to tip number 2, we have a little example here once again where I can move around and we can trigger this little checkpoint right here. So how are we exactly doing this? Let's find that out. We have this little checkpoint game object right here, which has a trigger box collider. And with this player class, which is attached to the player game object, we are triggering that checkpoint. And what's interesting here is that we are explicitly comparing the tag of the game object or collider that we are colliding with. And so this is not something that you should do because it is not a very performant thing to do. So what do we actually do in this case? Well, if you didn't know, UNC has its own compare tag method, which you can actually find in every single component class. So we can just put in the name of our tag right in here, which is trigger. And doing so will work just fine. It'll be just more performant, especially if you have a very tag intensive game where you have a lot of tags. Personally, I don't really like using tags, and what I prefer using is TryGetComponent. So what I'm doing right here is I am calling this TryGetComponent method, which returns a boolean, and that boolean will be true if this collider that we are triggering has this iTriggerable component. And if it does, then we get this variable that we can use, and we can then trigger our triggerable object. Now, this triggerable, of course, has this onTriggered method, and it is an interface which is implemented by our checkpoint class, just like so. And this checkpoint class that I mentioned earlier, it's attached to our checkpoint game object. And so I find this to be a more better way of classifying things. In a game, you wouldn't just have checkpoints that would use triggers. You know, maybe you have coins as well that connect as triggers. In that case, you can create another coin class which implements this iTriggerable interface. Tip number three. This one includes Unity's animation system. So I have made this little animation here. And let's just say I want to generate some confetti once this animation finishes. How do I do that? So, well, first of all, we need to create a script. And we have to make sure that script is attached to the same object where our corresponding animator is attached to. And if we take a look at that script, we have this summon confetti method right here, which just instantiates confetti. And we have to make sure that it's public, just so that we can be able to see it right here when we go ahead and add it, using this little button right here called Add Event. If we look to the top right, we got this little menu that showed up. And if we click on it, we can actually view all of the list of functions that are available, which we can call from this animation. And our summon confetti function actually showed up. And so we have attached it over here at the end of our animation. And yeah, it's right here. If we fire up the game now, we can actually see that we have our little confetti showing up. And so that's the powerful thing of animations. You can call functions from them. And this doesn't have to be right in the end. It can be right in the beginning somewhere, just like so. And that's it for tip number three. Moving on to tip number four. You can play animations in a reverse order without having to redo them. So using our animation that we've used previously in tip number three, if we go to its animation controller right over here, we can see that it has only one state. But if we go ahead and press Control D, we can duplicate this state right here. And let's rename it to weird animation in reverse, just so that we know how to distinct between them. And to play the weird animation in reverse, we just have to set the speed to -1. And in this way, you can also like speed up animations as well. And let's just set this state to be default, just so that it fires up right in the beginning when we launch our game right here. So as you can see, The animation plays in the reverse order. So that's it for tip number 4. And last but not least, we have tip number 5, which is something that I found out pretty recently when designing a UI for some game of mine. And it is that there are some UI effect components that you can use to make your UI of your game more fancy. What I mean by that is we have those little components right here. For example, shadow, which basically adds a shadow to any graphic component. And a graphic component is either a text, an image, or a raw image. And what's cool about this is that we can customize this little shadow component that we added. We can make it more bigger, make it more apparent right here. And I think it just overall is a really cool little neat feature to have. And this also works for images, like I said. So yeah, this is pretty handy. And another component is the outline component. Now let's just disable our shadow component so that it doesn't get in the way of our outline. Let's make this more darker and let's make this more bigger, just so that we can see. There we go. This also, like I said, works for images, and just like so. There is a little caveat though, and it's that these two components right here, they do not work for Text Mesh Pro components, which, if you didn't know, are a secondary, more efficient way of creating text. And that's just because Text Mesh Pro has its own functions already for adding outlines, shadows. So that's all for this video, folks. Thank you all for watching. I hope it was very informative. Let me know what tips and tricks you did know, what tips and tricks you didn't know. If you have any suggestions, please leave them down below in the comment section. And please leave a like if you really enjoyed this video. And I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye.